talk to you about the condition of the country. I heard that small issue you mentioned about the diagram role in the crop and report. The thing you have just designed is about how the crop active, right? But, and you also mentioned about the irritant. And I wonder, I just want you to describe more about the irritant.
Inhalation. This means you breathe in and your diaphragm is lower, it's stress and it's put more positive pressure. And the third part is the compression. This means the closet is closed. And the final part is inhalation. And this means when in your lungs it's like positive pressure and you push the air out.
What about the
irritant?
What about the irritant?
The irritant?
We have the
irritant.
What about the
irritant? In this case, anything else? In this case, I think the irritant, my sputum, is caused by inflammation of material and
inflammation. I think the color and quality of the sputum also significant symptoms for me to diagnose what is the disease.
You mean about the quantity?
Quantity?
Yeah.
Quantity.
Quantity.
Yes. And color.
Yeah, exactly. So what kind of use the material see on the sputum?
Green or wine, yeah. Green it has beautiful
color,
yeah. And sometimes light containing the
right. So what I do interest in the inflammation, mostly. So how my bacterial virus, so how I mean how you can explain more clearly about the condition of life when we are infected by the virus or the bacteria.
Thank you.
when the bacteria go into your lung and this the second mechanism after the first mechanism like we mentioned enough, the macrophage will engulf the bacteria. Then in this case, like bacterial tuberculosis, it has really a protein that inhibits the phagocyte, the engulf of the macrophage. It means they cannot engulf the bacteria because of protein that is released. And this is our material is tube. Yes, this is our material, and when it comes, the macrophage will engulf the bacteria. Normally, it will combine with lysosome. To destroy this bacteria. But in this case, the bacteria release a protein that inhibits this process. Or this might be here and latent in this thing. It's latent and don't have any symptom.
Choose outside and change to there. You can think about that question. How are you going to
cái này như đi ra cái hệ đồng hồ ấy nó thì đồng hồ là nó sẽ Thank you. Any other ideas that you want to add? Does everybody agree with the idea of Bohem and work?
Yes.
Does anyone have any kind of question that you would love to know more about coffee or the kinds of this?
You can add information like the bacteria or the virus can make the host to help to spread the disease to new hosts so it get more place.
Mm-hmm. Nice. Other questions that you want to ask?
There are different types of coffee, I think. So I just don't know what the difference is. That is, I couldn't find information. I know there's coffee festival, there are different kinds of coffee.
Mm-hmm. So good answer. Good questions,
right?
So any information didn't find out about different types of coffee? It's your friend is wondering. Can you write out your question and one against on the board and then a friend? Do you have two questions? First, different type of cough. And second, do bacteria make the host to cough to spread the disease? So, and I hear now?
Not intentionally.
Okay.
Because they don't think they don't have the spread, so they don't.
Okay, so if you don't have any idea right now, so you can memorize it, and then you can do a little bit of research later on when you come back home. Now are you okay to move to the next learning issue?
Yes.
Okay, so it's a nice sweat, okay? And who want to share with us your information in the loop? Okay, nice sweat. Do you got any kind of information about nice sweat?
Kind of
common. So, however, it is very common to people who get tuberculosis.
which is known as the TV latency. This kind of TV doesn't actually cause any clear symptoms to the host, and the host which is infected with TV latency often do not spread the disease throughout the air. But when the immune system of the host is decreased, especially in HIV AIDS cases, the TB in the body now will be active, and it will cause some clear symptom and damage the body. Some symptoms can be seen as fever, light sweats, chronic cough. Also, it will often damage the lungs of the host most, and also some small parts of the body as well. As I've seen on the internet, there are actually a lot of people who is infected with TB. It can be up to 25% of the world's population can be infected by TB, but in most cases, about 90%, they are just TB latent, which is not actually damaging the people who carry the disease, and only in cases of weak immune system, it will only activate the disease to the host.
Thank you.
body. So it can resist to many
Part of the lower lobe and the
why the lung is the most organ that TB is affected?
This bacteria needs oxygen, and the lungs have more oxygen. The organ has the most
好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好，好， The main reason I'm not going to give you the right answers is I'm very good at asking you questions, but
it's a few years since I read the textbook on TV, and in front of this audience, I don't want to give you the wrong information. Okay, but you can go and look that up. So where we are at the tutorial now is we're at the end of the step called the report back. The last question you had was, how does what you want to ask? We have to tell you, so we asked the students, how does TB enter the body? And they said by inhalation and by coughing. And they spreads by coughing. And we asked how TB spreads in the body, okay? And then we've clarified. I think, are people happy that we've clarified the wrong information? We just asked a question, okay? So we did that while you were out. When I said to them, so does TB spread, infect you via the blood? They all look very puzzled. What are you talking about? But anyway. So where we are at the tutorial, let me just show you. I'll just move this to the side. Do bacteria make the cough to spread the disease? I love what you said about, well, the bacteria has a little brain, but it is interesting how organisms evolve to their best advantage. There's no advantage to an organism if it kills off the host before they're able to spread it. So, yeah, so, okay. So, that's just to put you in context and say that this is the end of our demonstration tutorial. Every tutor has had a go. The PBL tutors are now learning the difference between telling you about stuff and asking you questions instead. And I think some of them at least are keen to give it a further go. So we have morning tea outside, and I'd like to welcome you all to enjoy the morning tea. Okay?
Em ơi,
and that you get together and you look at the videos and talk together about how you can improve or something like that, okay? Or even just, yeah. something like that, I think, would be really good to give you some practice in Vietnamese, particularly that practice of turning the information demand into a question. So we had an example in our group where one tutor was concerned that some wrong information had been given. And what I demonstrated at the end is how you can turn that around into a question, and then you find that the students actually know the right answer. Okay? So it's that skill of learning the question. Some feedback from the students, they all really enjoyed it. We had a student in the taxi this morning who was astonished as a first year student to be covering so much material, and really enjoyed the, you know, being actively involved like that. She really enjoyed it, didn't she? Trust you more. Some of the students found that process of us looking at them and waiting for them to talk a bit agonizing. But that's part of learning to do the PBL. You know, that's part, I explained to them that after a time, both the tutors and the students get in a rhythm, and there's much less of that just waiting, because the students know they can wait and wait and wait, but the tutor is not going to tell them the answer. In fact, if they wait too long, they'll get another question. Yeah. And just a little bit of feedback was around, they wanted reassurance that what they had said was right. And I said, well, in PBL, you won't get a tutor saying, that's right, although we did have some, that's because we're learning. But the tutor might say, oh, I like how you've done that diagram. From that diagram, I can see that you understand this. And that communicates in a different way the same message. You've done good work. Okay, but you turn it around and said, not that's right, but that I understand what you've done up there. So you encourage them to come to the board and show more. Okay, these are things that you will learn over the time if you just hang on to that one principle, that as an expert in a PBL tutorial, you're there to facilitate. And the minute you give them information, or even say, yes, that's right, next, no, that's wrong, you know, etc., you turn them into what we call spoon fed. They just want to sit there and have mother spoon the food in. And they have to be foragers. They need to go out and find their own sustenance. Keep that as your core principle and rehearse turning everything into a question. One other piece of feedback from the students was, the broad questions are good for getting the thing going, but then the practice of getting to the more specific question. Yeah, so that's an area, yeah, to help them narrow it down. And you may have noticed that the tutor prompts in the guide, they're the specific questions. It's the case writer has put them there to say, these are the bits you might have difficulty with, so here's some ideas and questions. You, I hope, will all be case writers. So in fact, the prompt questions, the specific things you want to get to, will in fact be your questions that you've put there for your use, just as a reminder in case you need them. So I think, you know, you can become a community of practice around PBL, and you can develop the practice of your community. Okay? So, and of course, Jill and I are always happy to be consulted. One possibility is that we can help you with the case writing, you know, but we will have this conversation with Kiet and Phu and others. Okay, so very, very quickly, I feel pressured for time. What I really like, what we would love to do if we have more time, is to actually get all of your thoughts now. How many of you are coming tomorrow to the clinical session in the morning? The clinical PBL session, is it a different audience? Yeah, a few of you will be coming to that. Yeah. Oh, okay. So it will be nice to get some, you know, feedback from people, maybe some at tomorrow's session. But just to make sure that we do capture some feedback, I have actually got here some evaluation forms, so I will hand those out afterwards. And Jill and I would ask that you be honest, that you say what you think, because we always could improve what we're doing for you. Okay, so just quickly, let's turn to PBL group dynamics, just in case your brains aren't full enough. But you've seen a beginner group, a beginning group, and you're starting to see who's active, who's not. And I've just put a little bit of information about group stages. So the idea in PBL is once the group is functioning, it learns really well. It flows, and the students enjoy the learning. But when a group is not working well together, it gets in the way of the learning. And that's why the tutor's role in helping the group to work becomes more important. I would regard learning about managing group function is a skill that perhaps the school might do an advanced PBL workshop on in future. So one of our advanced ones is asking questions, and another one around group functioning. Yep. Okay, so the tutor is watching and assisting group function. Let's talk first about stages of groups. What do we know about stages of groups? Believe it or not, there's a science behind it. Psychologists have studied it, but this is just a very simple model. It actually has stood the test of time as such a good model. It explains it and why replace it. So this is from Tuckman in the 1970s. So what we saw today, don't write anything down, because, or you know, you can write, but I'll give you the slides. What we saw today is a group forming. They're getting to know each other. I think that group of students actually now has a shared identity together. I think they'll seek each other out at school. Yeah. But they're forming. First off, they're polite. They're not yet sure if they're one of the good ones, or, you know, they sort of have a competitive eye when they first come in. So they're sort of judging how they fit and who's good at what, etc. So they're just forming, and they're often very polite at that stage. Okay. So they're saying hello, okay. Then there's norming. So they're getting a feel for each other. Already, I think, in this group, we're getting a feel for how we work. I'm getting the feel that there's a trust about how we're working. Okay? So there's the norming, which is like, me too, we're in this together. Norming's a great stage. It's like, yeah, we're doing this, we can do this. Okay? Sometimes in a group, though, somebody doesn't quite fit and the shoulders start to rub and people get a bit irritated and they do what's called storming. So we've got forming, norming, storming. I love how you know, models, they like to have words that rhyme and go together, acronyms, etc. So this is a difficult time for the tutor, and often it's about power plays, you know, and they split into cliques. And I've had this happen in a tutorial, it really disrupted the learning, and it's something you need to address very early on. And it's often because of sort of differences of personality style. But not every group goes through a storming phase, so it's not essential. We hope it doesn't happen. But once the group's formed and they're saying me too, then they get a real sense of how we work together. And they're really performing. It's like, let's go. And as a tutor, it's almost like, get out of our way. Just let us get on with it. You know, they really understand. As a tutor, it's such a lovely stage. Because although you're always listening, and as I said to my group, being a PBL tutor is the best rehearsal in critical thinking. You're constantly thinking and critiquing and thinking what else, etc. But your group is just flying. It's really good. You know, I kind of felt a little bit the other day in the tutor's tutorial that, you know, the group was really, you know, gelling and beginning to fly. Then the groups have to break up, okay? So we like our PBL groups to be together for a minimum of, you know, a half semester. Some places, they keep them together forever. Where in my institution, we don't, because we just occasionally have a group where you need to play with the dynamics by moving some people out, and so we do a shuffle of the groups. But that has some good, that has some good purposes because they share how they do PBL. Oh, well, I was in this group and we did that, and the other side, that was a good idea, let's try that, okay? But what happens is, of course, the mourning phase. So it's like, we have to stay together forever, we're going to be a study group forever, we're going to go out together forever. And we actually have groups who do that, and we have groups who, you know, all the way through to the final year, you know, they're always seeking to be in that group together. And if they're not actually put in the group with the in the curriculum, they'll be a study group. They're often a persistent study group. And, you know, sometimes even at each other's weddings. But the alternative is, it's, you know, it's like parting is such great sorrow, they decide, it's not that big deal. You know, it's not that big deal. I'm glad, you know, they're just beginning to get on my nerves, you know, it's okay. Yeah. Okay? So, stages of groups, and you'll see this as PBL tutors, and it's something you need to manage. So what do the tutors do? So when we're forming, and we did this, it's very important about the introductions, about helping the group to establish their rules. When they're norming, it's about encouraging students to take on different roles. So in my group, we have a couple of students, so there's one student who kept on getting up to the board, but now we've got a couple of students who are happy to get up to the board, and they're trying on these different roles, you know, and there's all sorts of roles that the students are prepared to try. And we, as tutors, we really encourage students to start taking different roles. In the storming phase, when there's challenges in the group, this is where the tutor actually has to think very carefully, what's the issue here? What's going on here? And what can I do about it? And this is where feedback to the group is really important. I actually think feedback to the group should actually be through all the stages because it's really important to keep the group self-aware. And I'll talk to you about group feedback in a minute, how you can do it. It's quite simple, but it's about keeping the group self-aware. When they're performing, obviously you can sit back and watch, but it's also the time to challenge them, push them that bit further, you know, like really drive their intellect with the questioning. So it can, and performing groups can be amazing. And then in the morning stage, the role of the tutor is really hanging on. So when I finish my block and say Gillian's the next tutor, we'll meet for a cup of coffee and we'll just go through, oh, this student's, you know, a bit quiet, and this student, you know, these ones are doing really well, and oh, I'm a bit worried about this one because the parents have decided to divorce and they're moving into state, and you know, that means the student is actually in a difficult place. So just keep an eye out for them. And then, you know, it might be, oh, this person's, you know, they tend to dominate a bit, but I think they're beginning to realise it's best if they don't. So those are the sorts of things that we hand on, okay, as tutors. And then there are roles. Okay, so what we saw was task roles mainly. So who's going to run? Who's going to scribe? We also, if a group is staying together, we say, would anyone like to be the group secretary? That's your point of contact for organising feedback meetings. Our students, because our tutors are long, they do a food roster, includes the tutor. I get my turn to bring food in. There are process rules, roles, and there are social roles. So, as we said, those are the task roles. The process roles you see emerging. And it helps you to understand, you know, different students' strengths and weaknesses. So there are some students who are really good at asking questions. So there was a student, Anne, in my group, and she asked the most questions of the other students. She didn't ask them of us, of me, of us tutors. She asked them of the other students. She's going to be a really useful student. There's the informal or expert. So we had a couple who, you know, really... you know, had an in-depth knowledge and who were, you know, took upon it themselves to do that informing. We had the explorer, that's often the questioner. We didn't see the clarifier, but mainly it was the tutor was doing that role. Some people like to focus. One of the feedback things I got from my students is a couple of students would have liked a bit more focus, but that's who they are, the explainer. Some people are good researchers. I have a feeling, I don't know whether, we had a student who used an iPad, and initially we thought, oh, she had her iPad and she couldn't, she wanted to explain something and she realized it was in her iPad but not in her mind and she couldn't explain it. But later, in fact, she had actually done a lot of quite good research and I noticed that she had written a lot of notes. And when we got into the area that she felt solid with, she really got on the board and did a lot of the really good stuff about macrophage phagocytosis and how the tuberculin, the MTB, how it resists that process and all of that kind of thing. So she had a lot of good. And sometimes there's a skeptic, someone who's prepared to sit back and say, I'm not sure I'm going to buy that story. And they're good too because they push. As groups evolve, you start to see social roles evolve. You haven't seen these yet, I don't think, but one student might be opinion leader, like the trendsetter, okay? One might be almost like the tutor, be a facilitator, someone who looks after people. One might be a good coach outside PBL, coaching young students. So there are many, many different sorts of social roles. How do we manage group dynamics? The most important part, I think, is group reflection. And that should be an ongoing process, and I'll tell you about that in a minute. We also have the opportunity to do feedback, individual feedback. We have that built into our process. You have the choice to build it into your process. But also, us modelling the process and modelling good reflection and feedback. So sometimes, your feedback might be, what feedback do you have about me as a tutor? So you model the idea that you were open and receptive to feedback about yourself, and that so that they are. So the habit that I've grown into is identifying a time in the PBL. So I evolved this process when I was doing cases that were three-step. Now we're doing two-step, and you will probably have a two-step process. But different tutors like to do this at different times, but what I like to do at the beginning of of a case, so obviously not the first case, but at the beginning of a case, after a couple, is to say to the group, I'd just like to do some feedback before we start. I found if I did it at the end, they were tired, and they just want to get out of the room because often there was a lecture scheduled straight after the PBL. So I do it at the beginning of a tutorial. I just say, how do you think we're going to get as a group working together? Is there anything we should change? So you're asking them a question, okay? Is there anything we should change? Give them a chance. And sometimes someone will say, I don't like the way we're sharing out the learning issues, or I feel like I'm not getting the chance to say anything. Those sorts of things. So you can be more specific if they're not saying, if you kind of go, well, is there anything you'd like to change? And we're looking at each other going, no, it's good, it's good, it's all good, all good. And you can say, well, is there any issue you think you would like to discuss? Okay, try it a different way. Okay, sometimes I'll come up with something. It might be something like, quite simple, like, we haven't got our schedules for our individual feedback. But sometimes that flows into a discussion. And then if I'm actually aware that there is a problem in the group, then I use my rules of feedback. So this isn't a session on how to do feedback, but it's specific. What is the specific behaviour I'm seeing? Descriptive. Can I describe the behaviour I'm seeing? And is this the right time? Is it timely? Now, obviously, we know another one is we think about the safety. So if it's about one specific group member, what I don't want to do is put them on the spot. That's very embarrassing for them and humiliating, and you'll alienate them. So something like that, where it's one individual, I would do an individual feedback. But for the group, I might say, what I'm seeing here is that we're doing the learning issues, but I've also noticed on your recording of how well you think you're studying, you're giving low ratings. And what I'm observing is I wonder if we're going into enough depth. You know, so you might give them an issue like that. What do you think about that? So that gives the group, just for you to be specific description. And so what I might do is, for example, in the case last week, our learning issue is this. And then you found that actually you also needed to consider all of these other issues. How can we change things so that we make sure that we go in depth and we report back? So you really is specific, descriptive, and timely, okay, in that feedback. Now, I have to practice good feedback now, as I have to say, it's been a hard morning for a lot of you, and we're all tired, we're heading towards lunch. Have you got any questions at this point in time? Anything you want me to explain further? Are you more happy to think about it and maybe come back to these slides as a resource should you need it for your PBL, or if you're talking about it as a faculty in your designing PBL, just going back to let's refresh our minds about what Julie was telling us about group feedback, something like that. But if anyone's got a burning question, you're all looking like it's nearly lunchtime, which is fine. So we have the option of individual feedback. Now I want to give you a handout. So it's not about numbers, it's about the conversation. So give it to the student first to fill out, just to get them thinking about each of these issues, okay? So we sit down and we say, okay, first, got any general issues you want to raise? This is where you'll hear from the students the stuff they won't say in the group feedback because it's awkward, it's difficult, okay? So anything you want to tell me, any general problems you have in the PBL? Sometimes, probably about 1 in 20 times a student will actually bring up a really big issue in that individual feedback. And then you say, okay, well, if things are going well, let's go through these points one by one. And how do you think you're going with generating hypotheses with the rational approach to the problem? And a student will say something like, oh, I'm still struggling with that. I think I'm reading too superficially. I'm mainly reading the digest textbooks. And so we have a conversation about, okay, so how can we improve that? You know, what ideas do you have for reading more deeply or studying more deeply? that sort of thing. So you can go down with the themes. So group learning process. So how do you think you're going in a group discussion? And most will say, oh, fine, yeah, I feel really comfortable with this group. And others will say, oh, yeah, I probably could do more of that. So, okay, so what kinds of things do you think you can do? So I had a student who was the true introvert, the most polite young man who was clearly intelligent. I knew in the group, he didn't say anything at all in the group, he just wasn't participating, but I knew his eyes were active and alive, I knew he was listening. And I said, you know, he said, oh, I know I don't participate in the group, I'm just finding it really, really difficult. And so I said, what ways do you think you could participate in the group? And he said, what would you be comfortable with? And he said, I guess sometimes I could get up to the board and write. And he wasn't comfortable speaking, but he was comfortable getting up to write. So the next few tutorials I watched, and I'd look at him and he'd nod, and he'd get up to the board and he'd write. And I'd be, I would give him indicators that was, you know, really good, or else I'll touch his shoulder on the way out of class and say, well done, you know, something like that. That young man became one of our top students. He became the president of the Students' Social Association. He flourished, you know, and he went, so you can just see these transformations, you know, people who just need the permission to become the grown-up they want to be. You know, it's really nice. And so there are many other sorts of behaviours. You can see the sorts of things there, the group processes. And then there's a kind of professional behaviour check. The professional behaviour check, it looks like, oh yeah, we're right on time, it's like an attendance list, but its function is actually to pick up the students who are in distress. Who's at risk and in distress? So this is where you pick up people who are running late because their family's broken up, mother's taken the car, they have to catch three buses. A lot of our students drive, okay? They have to catch three buses, it's taking an hour and a half, they have to drop a baby sister off before they get, you know. They're really struggling with their life, their external story, and you pick that up in the professional behaviour section. So this isn't something you have to do, this is a tool that we use to have a one-on-one discussion with the student so that we can get to know how they're going as a student, but also we can address group behaviour in this one-on-one. So sometimes I'll get the really quiet student and I'm helping them to speak up, and then we get the other students saying, I say, is there a general issue? And they say, oh, it's just John. It just does nothing. We feel like he's a passenger. So, and that's potentially an area where there could be group conflict. So you can turn to those students and say, why do you think that is? And you can say, what do you think you can do to help? And they say, well, I guess next time he tries to talk, I can kind of make sure I really listen and engage with him, make sure that I appreciate what he's doing, you know, encourage him. Yeah. Or I might take him for a coffee and check out if there's a problem, you know? So you can use this to actually work your group and work your group dynamics. Now, I'm aware of the time, and I think I've given you enough. I think you've thought about a lot, and I don't want to push your brains any further. There are a whole lot of exercises you can do around this behaviour to develop your tutoring, but I think for the school, perhaps that is in the realm of future activities. Okay, I'm aware of the time. So, are you happy with that, Jill?
Yeah.
So, I'd like to thank you first for being the most wonderful group of trainees. I really hope that this has given you a launch on your journey with active learning, PBL, and whichever form you take. I encourage you to learn from other schools as well. Linda's is but one school out of many who are doing PBL. I just encourage you to develop this community. I think if you can have an interest group who can help you develop as tutors, that would be great. And I'm handing out an evaluation form, and I'd like your honest opinion. So if you wouldn't mind just taking a minute to fill it out, and then as you leave, put it upside down. on here, so that I don't see your handwriting. So that if anyone's written something that's brutally honest, I won't know who said it. You know, if I have any grudge against anybody. I never do. I actually think we've all been families. Okay, so let's do that and then let's break. Finish the workshop. Oh. I feel like I've just made a whole community of friends and I have to say goodbye.
Has everybody got one?
Quickly with you, that I was really quite impressed with, is that you might not be aware, but the group that we had a big discussion about the resources that the students are using. The thing that I would like to share with you is that the group of students that were in our group communicated and set up a site with the students in the other group overnight to discuss and share information. So these students that you've got today are very, very clever collaborators already with using electronic devices. So they actually had shared chapters of Harrison's online on there. They had shared some original articles online and other resources. So the two groups, even though they weren't in the course doing this as their learning outcomes, they already have done it. So you'll find that your students will not only set up a Facebook group for themselves, they'll set up some for another couple of groups, they'll set it up for the whole year group. And I just thought I'd share that with you because I think that's pretty amazing.
think.